Coming up on Digital Music Trends 204 on the 15th of October 2014, Tom Yorke releases his album as a BitTorrent bundle, SoundCloud's major deals and financials, Tidal's hardware partners, Spotify profitable in the UK, the US's latest figures on album and digital track sales, the BBC's God Only Knows cover, and much more. Hello everyone and welcome to Digital Music Trends. I'm Andrea Leonelli and this is the weekly show where we talk about and try to make sense of the latest news in the digital music industry. And DMT is available on a wide range of streaming services, but also you can download it if you get apps like a podcast. It's now built into iOS 8, so you should have it on your phone. It's easier than ever to get the show downloaded on your iOS device. Or you can download Dogcatcher for Android. If you're on an Android device, it's also a very easy way to download podcasts. And if you'd like to receive weekly mail outs that let you know when the show is out, you can sign up on bit.ly/DMTlist. And we are back after a short break. It was the first break this year after more than 10 months of non-stop shows. So it was sorely needed. And thanks for downloading, actually, the back cataloging record numbers last week to make up for it. I was quite impressed when I came back and I was like, okay, this is pretty awesome, seeing that people actually went back and looked at some of the older shows instead. And to get back into the groove, if anything, you know, it's going to be a sleep-deprived show, as I only landed about 48 hours ago with the usual email backlog. I'm in the company of Darren Hemmings, the founder of digital marketing agency Motive Unknown. So hi, Darren. Thanks for joining me in this stripped back but chilled out version of the show. How's it going?
Good. Yeah, very good. I love this. It's like a one-to-one by the fire.
Exactly. It's like a fireside conversation.
Yeah, I'm feeling cozy for this one. No, you know,
it's getting cold outside. We got, you know, jumpers on, so it's a different feel to it, definitely, than the last show that I recorded, which was still in sort of mid-September. And there's been a lot going on since I left. I tried my hardest not to look at absolutely everything, because otherwise I would have probably passed out. But there've been a few stories that came up in the last sort of 2 weeks, because of course the show before this one was a pre-record on Music Apps Design, which was a great show, actually. I really enjoyed recording that one with Hannah and Rob. But we haven't had a proper news show in 2 weeks, and there have been a few things coming up that have caught my eye. I think I'd like to start this week by talking about the Tom Yorke BitTorrent bundle release. So Tom Yorke decided to release Tomorrow's Modern Boxes, his new solo album, as a BitTorrent bundle. You know, we've talked about BitTorrent bundles at length on the show before. In this case, the bundle includes a free track called The Brain in a Bottle and the video for the track. But in order to access the full album, fans will need to unlock the album and pay $6. So this is the first instance of a major artist actually using BitTorrent bundles with a pay to unlock feature to release an album. And judging by the number of downloads, it's doing pretty well. It's now 3.3 million downloads because the widget actually where you can embed the BitTorrent bundle has count, which is pretty handy actually, to see how many people have downloaded it, although we don't know how many people have actually chosen to unlock it. And he actually sent a letter out with the album detailing why he did this, and it was co-signed by producer Godric, who was also a sort of co-conspirator when they started the whole Spotify controversy last year. And you know, they talk about the fact that it's an experiment to see if the mechanics of the system are something that the general public can get its head around. And, you know, they want to bypass self-elected gatekeepers. And by that, they are referencing directly to Spotify in the letter. And they keep reiterating that artists need to fight the Spotify thing, essentially. So an interesting release here. It's going to be, I wonder whether he's going to release any numbers around how many people actually unlock the album. Darren, what do you make of this? Do you think that this is sort of a validation for BitTorrent bundles, and will we see more artists doing this in the future?
I mean, there's no question BitTorrent has certainly had a field day on it. You know, there was certainly that guy from BitTorrent whose name has just totally escaped me. Matt somebody, I think.
Yeah.
Was everywhere, kind of, you know, putting the shoe in on major labels and everything else. All of which I found a little bit sad, really. A bit kind of like, you know, I mean, here's Tom Yorke in Tom Yorke's mind trying to be a sort of, you know, taking a stand or whatever, you know, and trying to do something good and stick it to the man. And And at the end of the day, all you really have is a guy from another large tech company, which is not open source, which is not, you know, it's not a charity, standing there loving the free promotion that Tom Yorke has brought in, you know, and it just gave that guy a chance to prattle on a great deal about how awful the majors are, all of which was a little bit tiresome and just flat out wrong in a lot of its assertions, really. So it was all a bit pathetic. And I think you have to separate two things here. You know, it's the validity of the BitTorrent bundle to any artist, with the emphasis on any, versus kind of this, you know, Tom Yorke setup, where it just everything about it kind of really didn't sit well with me. I think mainly because of the tone around it, you know, this unbelievably sanctimonious kind of tone to the emails and everything else. And this whole thing about self-appointed gatekeepers, he is the fucking self-appointed gatekeeper. He's the one pushing out. So just none of it stood up. It was kind of like, but you know, so it's all right when you're the gatekeeper, or you know, or BitTorrent are the gatekeeper, but there's always a bloody gatekeeper because there's someone there, you know. And I just don't really, you know, the success or the validity of a BitTorrent bundle, I think, is entirely open to discussion. Yeah. I think where it fails is that, and what Tom Yorke completely ignores, having been, obviously, we should point out, someone who has, you know, emerged and developed an A&R'd through the major label process, so is entirely, you know, as everyone's covered a million times before, even around in rainbows and the whole giveaway on that. You know, the guy was built around the major label process. He has the traditional model to thank for his fame, not that he will. And as such, it's, you know, it's very easy for a kind of millionaire rock star with millions of fans worldwide to stand up and go, oh, I'm going to use this new platform. And lo and behold, I got a lot of downloads.
Yeah.
Of course you did. You're famous. But that's completely ignoring what labels do, you know. And I mean, labels, take the term as you will, because a label these days can just be, you know, the management, the band, or whomever. But, you know, generally, I think it's a given that labels, you know, the principle is that they also break bands.
Yeah.
And BitTorrent won't break a band. BitTorrent commits nothing. It's just there. It's just another platform. And as somebody else pointed out, you know, I think the maths were done, and it would have been, I think Tom Yorke would have gotten more money had he done this through Music Glue, because I think Music Glue take less of a percentage.
Right.
Music Glue being obviously a kind of direct-to-fan platform of sorts, but mostly involved in, you know, ticketing, and they provide websites and things as well. Really good company. Big fan of them. But you know what I mean? It's kind of like Tom Yorke selling something online direct to fans, when you strip out the whys and the wherefores, is... It's not that different, is it?
Yeah.
The fact that the platform is BitTorrent versus, you know, Topspin, Musical.ly, whatever, is by the by, really. It's still, you know, the BitTorrent still took a percent. You know, it's just all, I don't know. It irritates me because it's wrapped, as with his entire Spotify argument, it's largely wrapped in very, very shitty wisdom. And you know, he is not really the person to be speaking on behalf of the artist community, because he's not a struggling artist, he's not an emerging artist. So on that level, he has no idea what it's like to work to be built up in the here and now, as opposed to the late 90s with EMI backing you.
Yeah. I mean, at the same time, I guess, like, since it's just the two of us, I should take the devil's advocate position and go the other way, right? I was just trying to figure out, you know, what kind of, for somebody that has taken the position that he has taken towards streaming services, and somebody that has allegedly sort of created this, you know, spurred along, I guess, the whole D2C sector, or at least a lot of people are crediting him with giving it a big push with the In Rainbows release. I wonder what options he had when it came to releasing an album in a way that wasn't iTunes-centric, that did make a bit of a splash in terms of news, because of course, you know, a traditional D2C Music Glue type or release would not have made as much noise in, you know, although arguably, you know, his music, you know, because it's Tom Yorke, should have been well publicized anyway. And so I'm just wondering what he was left with at that point that could have created an impact, and there was a technology that was readily available, and that looked interesting, because of course, you know, we've always said that BitTorrent bundles look pretty interesting as an option. And so I just wondered what other option he had. Of course, you know, that's not to say that the tone of the letters wasn't kind of as he said, pretty sanctimonious, but I also wonder sort of where else he could have gone. If he couldn't go to streaming services because of what he stated already, couldn't go to iTunes because that's of course a massive gatekeeper, and you know, in that sense chose to go with a company that is not yet proven, and perhaps this can you know spur a few more people to try out the service and see if the whole paywall for unlocking works. I don't know, so yeah, it's an interesting one.
What really sort of sticks in my throat with it is perhaps that the entire kind of artist rights debate is now being used just to sell Tom Yorke records.
Right.
You know, and you're right. It's kind of using BitTorrent is more interesting and gets him more attention. But then you're not really, you know, if you want to go and fight the whole streaming debate, then can you not do it around an album release when it's very easy for a cynic like me to sort of say, well, is this really about rights and revenues, or is this just you trying to sell more albums? Because there's a nasty overlap between the two, and yeah, just it doesn't, you know, I just think really with Tom Yorke, I mean, he is of course welcome to an opinion, and of course I think the streaming debate sort of, it does rumble on, and I think it's worth having. You know, there should be people from both sides having a reasoned debate about this. It's just unfortunate that on a broad level at the moment, that's not really happening, because you tend to get the extremists on the anti-brigade on the one side, and you get the companies on the other, which isn't to say that Spotify are extremists, but obviously they're going to fight their corner with their own, you know, not spin, but their own, you know, their own agenda and everything. That's fair enough. That's what they do. They're, you know,
right.
What company wouldn't? you know, I mean, I run a digital marketing company, so, you know, only an idiot would, you know, I'd have to be a real idiot to sit there and then argue against the value of digital marketing. You know, it doesn't stand up. But it's just unfortunate that the sort of middle ground, where there's actually some quite reasonable points and a bit more consideration and not this kind of beholden view that you're either for or against, and that, God forbid, you couldn't swap sides or see both sides or anything like that. You know, none of that gets any press or attention because it's sort of not sexy enough. Whereas it's much easier for people like Tom Yorke to stand up and make these kind of fairly rash, you know, reasonably uninformed comments and everything else from this position as, frankly, you know, an established privileged rock star.
Yeah.
And you know, and I just think when that's coupled with this whole thing of, you know, you know, I hate Spotify, fuck Spotify, I'm using BitTorrent, buy my record. It's like, well, hang on, what's your point? Is this just to sell more albums, or do you actually genuinely care? And I think, you know, I had more time for it when Nigel Godrich kind of spoke out last time, because at least he wasn't just doing it to promote something. Yeah. So it's hard, and I just think maybe there's a point at which Tom Yorke, as welcome as he is to his opinion, needs to accept that he isn't necessarily the best person to lead this debate. And you could even go a step further and argue that actually he's potentially harming the debate. Because as long as you have an overprivileged kind of rock star in an established position arguing these points, maybe people are going to dismiss them outright, just going, well, but you're a millionaire, Tom. You're a global star. You're not really the guy we're going to sit and listen to moaning about lack of payment, because we've, you know, a decade plus of piracy has proven that, frankly, the average punter in the street couldn't care less about your revenues. And you know, and indeed, Mark Mulligan did a recent survey thing on his music industry blog, you know, among a sort of set of 1,000 respondents. And it's not a shock, but, you know, funny enough, even now, people don't really care about what artists make for their music.
Yeah.
So his whole debate is sort of undermined as well by the fact that Joe Public, sadly, doesn't really care that much.
And also, you know, I went to quite a few conferences over the last 3 months around Europe, and it feels like the debate has really moved on from trying to pinpoint Spotify as being, you know, a gatekeeper in the sense, in a negative sense. You know, I feel like the vast majority of artists that I've spoken to and labels, of course, express concerns around the fact that they are not getting as much money, but the overall sentiment is positive. if I can sort of make this generalization as to what I've been hearing anyway, both from the independent and the major players, the overall sentiment is positive towards Spotify now. And there are, of course, concerns around what kind of split gets then sent back to the artists, but that's sort of a contractual matter between the labels and the artists rather than a problem that Spotify is directly involved with. So yeah, we'll see how that shapes up. And I wanted to move on to talk about SoundCloud. So last week, there were a couple of news related to SoundCloud that were not in the most positive nature, unfortunately. So first of all, the Financial Times, Robert Cookson, reported that the company has hit a major impasse in regards to its negotiations with major labels. This was not confirmed or denied by either SoundCloud or the major labels, but the report contradicts earlier rumors that majors had already gotten equity in the company in exchange for licenses and states that Universal abandoned the negotiating table weeks ago. Warner and Sony are also apparently holding out for better terms. On the other hand, filings with Company House for 2013 have shown that revenues grew 40% in that year to 11.2 million euros, but operating loss more than doubled to 23.1 million euros, more than double its revenues. And according to TechCrunch, given the company's financial situation at the end of 2013, and its continued expansion, it shouldn't be long before it needs to raise more capital. So two pieces of news that are not that great, but we're still talking about a company that has developed a hugely loyal user base, contributed to breaking major artists, and is on track to reach 200 million listeners each month. So, Darren, let's stay positive. I want to look at the silver lining here. So, where is the silver lining here, and how can we see the situation turn around for SoundCloud going forward?
positive. Yeah. I think, yeah, do you know what? I'm struggling.
It's a very difficult question.
Yeah.
Right.
I have to be honest. I really think they're in trouble, right. Genuinely, you know, and I'm not the only one. You know, I was talking to somebody recently who said, you know, this is starting to bear a worrying resemblance to MySpace and what happened with them, where their sort of attempts to legitimize their audio streaming and everything kind of ultimately, you know, precipitated the downfall of the company. I mean, the sheer volume of users and everything that SoundCloud has doesn't mean it can't come crashing down. It absolutely can. And MySpace is a perfect example. You know, I mean, I would argue Last.fm's an equally sort of valid example of companies that built huge numbers of users and impressions and all of these things, and yet became ultimately worthless and therefore crashed and burned, really. So I must confess, the more I contemplate SoundCloud's current position, the more I find myself wondering, you know, how they can weather this without it turning into quite a disaster. Only because, you know, let's look at the facts, you know, or at least as much as we know of the facts, I guess it's probably fair to say. You know, they had negotiations with Twitter about acquisitions and such like. But within that, it became pretty clear that Twitter realized that without licenses, they had nothing, no means to monetize, you know. So without that on board, they were going to have a problem.
Yeah.
Furthermore, I think Twitter realized that the minute if they were to buy the company before those licenses were in place, then the cost would absolutely skyrocket, because everyone would know that it's Twitter, and Twitter have deep pockets.
Yeah.
So the negotiations
not so deep, actually,
shift.
But you know.
Well, no, actually, yes, fair point. Yeah, they're not as rich as a bulk of others, but certainly, you know, yeah, having owned the company, having bought the company, that price would only go up.
Yeah.
And you know, apparently that's what drove Twitter away from the acquisition point. If that's true, it suggests that most other companies would also shy away from an acquisition on SoundCloud for the same reasons, because they're now in this troubling catch-22 where, you know, they don't have licenses and they're a chronic liability without them. At the same time, you have the majors playing a real hardball game here, where they're basically saying, you know, these are the terms we want. And at the moment, SoundCloud are refusing to roll over on those. But as these recent financials have suggested, you know, they are hemorrhaging money. I mean, their losses they didn't make enough money to even pay their wage bill. Which, as an aside, I have to say, looked to my fag packet maths to be surprisingly high. I worked out that every it averaged $60,000 a year for every employee. So someone in SoundCloud is earning a ton of money if that's the way it pays out.
Well, $60,000 is actually not that much. I mean, it's a lot, but for you...
It is when you're talking the average for every single employee on the books. You know, that's a high average. I would think the average for any company would be closer to 40 or something. I don't know. I mean, maybe I'm wrong, but it just struck me as quite high, just as an aside and a personal observation. But you know, they are seriously losing money, and you know, and they're entirely investor backed. And I think the tides are turning a little bit where that's concerned, and investors aren't perhaps as kind of optimistic as they used to be around this whole sort of it will shake out in the end. So, I mean, I just think where they're currently concerned, they're sort of at this very strange position where, you know, they have exceptionally high outgoings. You know, I think VCs are not necessarily going to have limitless time to you know, and funds to support this. So they're really going to be under the cosh. But then I think the issue is actually less the money and what the final product is that SoundCloud come back with.
Yeah, exactly.
Because what you then reach is a point where the majors are going to dictate terms because SoundCloud are not in a dominant bargaining position. And then what you end up with is a product that may well be so far from what the original, you know, concept of SoundCloud was that it will alienate the user base. And everyone will be like, you know what, yeah, this isn't what I signed on for, which is basically what happened with MySpace. You know, I mean, MySpace was aging badly anyway, and they had a bunch of user interface issues and stuff like that. But it was kind of the relaunch, the you know, and I don't mean the recent relaunch, I mean more the, you know, their ability to license and everything first time round. That, yeah, when they tried to relaunch with all of that, it was kind of the thing that broke the straw that broke the camel's back relative to users going, this isn't the platform that I think it is, and we're going to move on. So,
yeah,
which I know sounds wildly pessimistic.
I've got a silver lining for you if you want.
Go on then.
I'm thinking that, you know, I think the fundamental mistake here has been the fact that, you know, if they didn't have the deals with the major in the first place, as reported from the earlier, you know, articles of a couple of months ago, where they actually reported about the equity and, you know, that there had already been equity assigned to majors and the deal was closed and that everything was fine. And that created a lot of grief also in the independent community, you know, talking about, you know, how did they get first dibs on equity, of course, if SoundCloud was founded on independent content. And I think, you know, if that wasn't true, I mean, I don't understand why that wasn't denied at the time, if the deals are actually not yet set. Because, you know, why would they assign equity to majors if there wasn't a licensing deal in place? And it sort of created a bit of a interesting situation with the independent community, which essentially formed SoundCloud, because, you know, they felt betrayed in a sense by the company. And so I think, you know, if the company manages to steer itself back a little bit and continue to, you know, be a fundamentally an independent platform, and at the same time really focus on audio content, which is something that they actually have been doing for quite some time, you know, perhaps it hasn't been as broadly advertised, but, you know, they have so many podcasts and, you know, spoken word content. If they can encourage and cultivate that, then they have a real shot at continuing to grow in the way that they were doing before. But the licensing question mark is, of course, one that needs to be answered at some point. And so, yeah, I have no comeback on that. But I'm hoping that, you know, if they realize that catering to the majors, as like you said, would not work in their favor, and so what can they do instead? That's sort of the sticking point.
But the problem is that they're, you know, they are VC funded,
right?
And VCs aren't interested in being a reduced niche independent platform. That's not their play. They want the biggest, most commercial terms, you know, to get the largest global reach and deliver something that will, you know, flip into a multi-billion dollar cash out for them. That's why they put their money in. So as lovely as it is sort of notionally for the service to be a sort of independent one, I mean, all I could think when you were describing it was Bandcamp, to be honest, you know, which Bandcamp is great. It's a profitable business and it's a great service.
Everybody loves it, yeah.
But it doesn't have anything like the reach and scale of a SoundCloud, and that's the difference. Is it, yeah. You know, with that comes, you know, the value around it would be reduced as well, I would imagine. So, yeah,
I tried.
Yeah, no, I mean, that's the thing. I don't like being the voice of doom on it. You know, I know people at SoundCloud. You know, I've talked to Alex Young. I've got a lot of time for all of them. I think they're all very smart people. But when you step back and weigh up the current way things are looking, I can't help but feel rather pessimistic about their future, because it's almost a bit like they've got caught with their pants down on this one. You know, they're no longer in a position of dominance relative to the negotiating table. And I think the majors, I mean, I'm cynical around the majors at the best of times, but I can't help but feel that them walking away from the negotiating table may well simply be just another move. It's all theatre, you know. They walk away and then they'll come back a little bit later and go, oh, you know, all right, look, we're not fussed. Like, you can go under, we don't care. Or you can just accept these terms and then we can all be, you know, nice about it and things like that. And yeah, I just wonder if that is their play here, because it seems like a logical one to me. You know, it's not a pleasant one, but it's a logical one. You know, it kind of makes sense when you think it through. So, I would stress
that we don't really know anything. We know that what the Financial Times has reported, which probably is things that are coming from the major camps. So I would imagine that it's fairly accurate. And the Financial Times usually doesn't mess up too much on this kind of stuff. So I would imagine they would have gone with a pretty certain sort of bit of information, but none of the companies have confirmed or denied anything around this, so we're gonna have to sort of wait and see what happens. Really, there's not much else to do. And a service that actually I've talked about on the show already with a guest spot from a company executive is the upcoming CD quality streaming service Tidal, which is I found it pretty exciting. I like the design of it. I think it's an interesting idea. This week we heard more about the company's launch plans and especially its hardware partnerships. So surprisingly, Tidal lists Sonos as at the top of the list, surprisingly, because these are actually appear to have forged a special relationship with Sonos for the launch of Deezer Elite. But I guess that relationship wasn't quite as special as we thought it was, because Tidal is also going to be launching on Sonos, which makes sense because Sonos, of course, is a piece of hardware that can be used with any service. So it wouldn't make sense for them to tie themselves to any one partner. Tidal also counts Denon, Harman, Blue Sound, and NAD, and then a few other much more niche companies like Meridian, O'Rellik, Electrocompaniet, Simple Audio, Raumfeld, Dyn Audio, Audio Vector Project, Arable, and TuneIn Media, and a couple of others. Honestly, I haven't heard of probably like 3/4 of these before, so I'm not
whoever they are.
I have to be honest, right? But along this with this list of 16 audio partners so far, Tidal will be available also on iOS and Android devices, and on web players for Mac and PC. And it will be, of course, launch in the US as we reported a few weeks ago. And Tidal looks to garner a lot more partners here, and they want to expand to as many as 50 countries worldwide. And of course, the overheads are high. You know, they can be profitable much quicker because the service is going to be $20 a month instead of just $10. And it seems like an interesting proposition here. But I'm all for it. Of course, you know, it's not high definition. It's not Pono-like sound quality. I heard actually the Pono live for the first time a few weeks ago, and it sounded pretty amazing. That was with pretty amazing headphones as well. So I should try.
And isn't that the catch with all of these? It's like, true. When I listened on 10 grand's worth of audio equipment, funny enough, it sounded great.
Yeah. it's not high definition in that sense. I think it's going to be 24 bit. Still much higher than Spotify. You know, Darren, are you excited as I am, or what do you make of these new HD, or not HD, but like, you know, higher definition offerings?
Yeah, I'm sort of puzzled by them. I mean, my you know, I like good quality audio, and my father in particular is a sort of rampaging audio snob,
right?
And has this extremely high end. He's the only guy I know with a quad amped system, which is an amp where every channel is individually amped.
Wow!
So that it's, you know, they're all sort of separately powered, which. I think if we're looking for a benchmark for excess when it comes to audiophilia, if that's a term, that's probably a good place to start. There's no denying, you know, on my dad's system, I mean, music sounds astonishing. You know, when you're just hearing something and it's like, you know, it's just like there's a party in your ears because it's just so detailed and beautiful. So in that respect, yes, I get it. But as I kind of glibly remarked earlier, I think, you know, with a lot of these things, it's complemented by a high-end system. And equally, you know, Spotify on its kind of 320K setting doesn't sound that bad either, because it gets kind of warmed up quite a lot by good amps and, you know, good audio processors and stuff. I mean, I'm sure there's a market for it. And, you know, ironically, you'd think my dad would be a in the market for that. But perversely, my dad's perfectly happy with Spotify. And I think a lot of it is because his equipment just makes anything sound better. You know, it always did. That's kind of what you pay for. You know, if it was just the case of the audio format dictating the quality, then there'd be an argument that there'd be no world of hi-fi, because we'd all just need a player and a speaker, you know, or a pair of speakers or whatever, you know. But it's not like that. You know, there's a whole bunch of signaling processing that goes in along the way that dictates what comes out. But as a consequence, one could argue that Spotify on its highest setting would do very well. From a sort of step back and bigger picture perspective, my only other one worry is just whether at some point someone like Spotify would simply introduce a super extreme tier for another couple of dollars a month. I mean, that's the other bit for me, is I don't really know who'd pay 20 whatever it is, pounds, dollars, euros a month for this. You know, you there's definitely a market, but I would imagine it's a very small market of, you know, I would venture to guess, you know, men over 40, probably more likely over 50, who are real audiophiles, have the kind of income levels that, you know, they have a very luxurious audio setup. And, you know, I think, you know, men over 50 are still very tech savvy, and who would appreciate a kind of streaming service to match this. But yeah, it's very, very niche, very niche. And so as nice as it is, I can't get massively excited about it, only because if I was pitching for that, you know, I would be sat there just wondering what's to stop Spotify, once it's established market dominance, just opening a super audio tier to carry the snobs. And I suspect part of the reason Spotify hasn't done it is because they might be concluding there's simply not big enough a market to bother, which then begs the question, where's the market for Tidal and, you know, Deezer Elite or whatever it's called, and those sorts of things. So it's a funny one. I sort of wish them well with it. I think, you know, definitely a market. It's not like some startups you see where you're just sat there thinking, you know, what the hell were you smoking when you conceived this, because nobody cares. You know, that's a solution to a problem that doesn't exist type thing. But with this, I just sort of think, you know, it's tricky to get massively excited.
I think you know, the thing that I found interesting was the fact that they decided to go for this and just release the Elite the Tidal service as a separate thing, because they realized that the cost structures were going to be so much more interesting, because they already have all the catalog, they already have the servers. How can we launch a service that is fairly low cost for us to launch? We don't have any free part of it, so we don't have any expense on that side from the licensing point of view, and essentially, you know, we can probably start making money after the first few thousand customers are signed up to the service, which is a very different proposition than what most other services are doing today. Of course, you know, entirely niche, as you said, but nevertheless, an interesting way to sort of tackle that problem. The issue that you mentioned is real, in the sense that, from what I understand, all or most of the services that are out today as streaming services, they receive the files as WAV, uncompressed, from the distribution services, and then they compress them at different levels to cater for their different types of distribution models. And of course, Spotify changes the bandwidth depending on your connection, if you're on your phone and stuff like that. And so there's nothing to stop them from releasing those uncompressed files as a service. I'm not sure what that does to the licensing side of things, because I'm pretty sure that Tidal and Wimp paid more to the rights holders for the high definition streams than it did for the normal streams. I would have to sort of, it would really depend on the contracts that the services have with the labels, whether they would have to negotiate different rates for the full quality streams as opposed to the MP3 streams. I'm not really sure what the deal is on that front. Very. I think it's interesting to see all the services come through. Of course, seeing these are coming to the market as well, it's probably dampened the enthusiasm for Tidal a little bit, because we're seeing a bit of a battle happening here. Pono is launching early next year or later this year as a service as well, and they will have real high definition service. So it's definitely an open field here. But good to see stuff happening anyway. I'm happy to see companies invest in this.
I think it's an interesting area. Like I said, I wish them well with it. I just feel it's a niche and possibly a little bit easily kind of trumped by the dominant players in the space. But right, good luck to them. And if it may be that they become a sort of possibly unwelcome footnote in the sort of history of the introduction of high end streaming. Because that's how it goes, isn't it? You often get people break that area, go into that new territory with this sort of an offering, and then actually they kind of die off because they couldn't stay the distance, but someone else steps in. But for the consumer, it's a good thing. So, let's see how it goes.
And on the streaming front, Spotify actually posted a profit for 2013 in the UK. Yay! £2.5 million, an impressive result, especially as in 2012 the company posted an £11 million loss. And this, again, is from the company house filings as per the SoundCloud case. The growth was fueled by a 42% spike in subscriptions for 2013, which was aided by its partnership with Vodafone, which is a mobile carrier in the UK, and the launch of a student discount. And the total revenue for the UK subsidiary increased 40% to £131.3 million for 2013. So good news there, and we'll see whether that's replicated elsewhere around the world. But I think some of the streaming skeptics would have doubted that Spotify could turn profitable, even if just in a territory like the UK, so quickly. So that can only bode well for 2014.
No, that's right. I think it's it's a good sign, and I think it's good to just have some positive news in a real sense. There's been lots of good news out generally by way of growth in this area, but to see kind of profit particularly, I think is very welcome. And as you say, it's possibly likely to calm some of the detractors around this model. I think it's unfortunate because Spotify has become the whipping boy for this one because they are the most prominent, and that's the sort of goes with the territory, I guess, of the streaming services. And it's interesting how quiet some of the others have been in not stepping forward to defend this model when perhaps it's being so publicly attacked. But it's good to see. But I think it sort of also demonstrates that, there's a market shift going on among consumers and consumption of this stuff. And it's funny how even now, labels are still quite backward in their view on this, despite the fact that, a lot of the small labels that Motive Unknown works with, we see the Spotify in particular has really risen to be, the number two on their income streams, but not just sort of number two with a considerable drop off, but number two and very much nipping at the heels of iTunes. And my own theory on it is just that I think Spotify has become the equivalent of sort of standing at the counter at the indie record shop, just being able to check music out. It's lowered the barrier to trying new music and seeing if you like it. Yeah. And so you get a lot more adoption, where people are prepared to take a punt on a new artist because they're already paying for the subscription. There's no you know, demand on them beyond clicking play. And so for smaller labels where they tend to focus on new and emerging artists, I guess it's probably safe to say, you know, it really is growing on that area because it's allowing people to connect with the bands. What I find interesting is how much of a mission it still is to get labels to even mention Spotify in advertising and posts. It's funny how much everyone's like, the album is out, buy it on iTunes.
Yeah.
When particularly when you're talking about new artists, you know, I keep pushing for the messaging to be, you know, buy on iTunes or stream on Spotify here, or, you know, stream on your service of choice here with a smart URL or anything like that. But it's, yeah, it's just interesting the degree to which, despite the revenues leaping, there's still a sort of slight reticence around it in certain quarters of the music industry. Yeah. But no, I think the, you know, the profit report is good. It's a good look for Spotify. It's a good look for streaming services in general. And I really hope it will just be a slightly more balanced piece of evidence to, you know, to hopefully, as I said earlier, sort of provoke more genuine, reasoned debate, because at the minute it feels like you've got sort of Tom Yorke, David Lowry and others on the one side, and then you've got Spotify on the other, and yeah, just a slightly more kind of objective analysis of these things is probably quite welcome. But yeah. Overall good for them, you know, good development.
And often we have to wait for a company to file for an IPO to actually figure out what the actual financials are. We don't really know how much money Spotify is making overall or losing overall or anything like that. So we were all wondering whether an IPO would happen this year. I don't think it's going to happen at this point. There's been no further rumors on that. So it's probably been put off until at least next year. There's also been a slew of underperforming IPOs happening, which probably didn't help the climate for that to happen. And so and probably the company is waiting to get some better numbers in terms of profits in order to boost the IPO price. So that all makes absolute sense. But after positive news from Spotify, there were a bit of a negative news from Nielsen SoundScan, as they reported that in the US for Q3 album sales, or at least for the first 9 months of 2014, ending with the end of Q3 at the end of September, album sales fell 14.4% overall, and digital track sales fell 12.9%. So in 2014, not a single artist album has hit the 1 million sales mark, with Beyoncé's being the highest selling with 776,000 sales. This compares negatively with 2013, when there were five artist albums that had sold over a million units in the first 9 months. Similarly, in 2014 so far, 23 fewer tracks reached the 1 million sales mark, 60 instead of 83 in 2013. Universal Music has extended its lead over Sony Music. It's now at 38.3% market share, and Sony Music is a whopping 10.5% behind that. And the independent market is actually doing pretty well. Billboard does very well in highlighting the fact that if you look at the sector by ownership, it has about a 35% market share, whilst Nielsen SoundScan currently classes independent releases distributed by majors as being major releases, which reduces that share from 35% to 13.7%. Vinyl is doing very well, up 47.5%, and I would just like to highlight that while Q3's figures and you know, the figures for the year overall appear to be pretty bad news for the recorded music industry, it's important that to note that Nielsen SoundScan only records sales, and of course we have no idea exactly how streaming is doing, but the presumption is that it's doing very, very well. And so we'll have to wait until the end of the year, I guess, to really figure out whether their income's coming from streaming. And we know that Spotify is on track to pay around $1 billion a year, from what I read a few weeks ago, you know, whether that is going to really tip the scales and bring us into positive again. It might take another year or two before that happens. You know, this slowdown is pretty fast to be caught up by streaming, but, you know, unfortunately, also, we won't get an Adele album this year. It's just been confirmed, I think, last week. And so that's not going to lift sales. But hopefully Taylor Swift will, because she does have an album coming out at the end of October. And usually that comes in at the 1.1, 1.2 million mark at least. You know, mixed news here. But again, we don't have any figures on streaming. So perhaps not as meaningful as it was a couple of years ago, right?
Yeah, I mean, I think at the risk of souring the tone, it's unavoidable that you know, the sales are dropping. Sales on, you know, album sales, track downloads, physical, they're all declining. I mean, vinyl sales going up a certain percent. It's sort of, you know, if you were to look on the pie chart, you'd struggle to see the vinyl bit because it's like a hairline, you know, it's such a tiny percentage of the overall sales. So that is nice for vinyl, but not really for income. Yeah, and I think it is unavoidable. Sadly, you know, the track sales are going to decline, and as a result of which, you know, there will be a gap there, because as rapid as the rise on streaming is, it is not filling the gap left by the decline in sales across downloads and physical. So, nor will it. I don't think anyone is expecting it to for, you know, probably 5 years at least. And so things are going to get tight, you know, and you're seeing evidence of that. You know, the majors are sort of cutting back, and there's a lot more outsourcing going on and all these kinds of things. I think it's a negative if you're looking at the sort of 5-year forecast. I think if you're looking beyond that to a, you know, a 10-year forecast, it's positive. It's a transitional phase, and, you know, it will kind of shake out in the end relative to, you know, the models people use and things like that. So, yeah, it's a bit gloomy. But, you know, I mean, oddly, a lot of the labels that we deal with at Motive Unknown, certainly, you know, very optimistic. You know, everyone's still, I don't think everyone's sat there thinking, oh, God, you know, it's all going to hell in a handcart. I mean, the places I see it where it, I would be more worried is the majors, where I think they've previously had quite a lot of leeway to commit time and money on things to great effect. You know, things like the Ed Sheeran campaign being a very good case in point, you know, where, you know, they've really put a lot of time onto that and created a brilliant, you know, really effective campaign, and all power to them. But, you know, as things contract, one wonders whether that they will have the luxury of that time to really develop it, and, you know, and things like that. But yeah, I mean, you know, it's a changing market, and we adapt accordingly. You know, I think even, you know, on a personal note with Motive Unknown, it's kind of, there's, we acknowledge that the market will contract. Oddly, what we didn't expect was that we would get more inquiries because people will outsource. Right. So you'll have more people coming to us because they've shut down their internal departments. But, you know, there's a need to broaden horizons, because if you rely solely on artist campaigns for your business model, then, you know, it still may hit a rough spot where the economics don't really stack up in a manner that, you know, it can make it worthwhile. And we've seen this before. I remember James Pennicate at Ooh Brilliant, you know, writing a great blog post probably about 18 months ago about the world of PR, and just saying, you know, you're sort of reaching a point where people are saying they don't have the money to pay, so now the PR people are working on twice as many campaigns, and they're sort of, the effectiveness of their job is getting chipped into because they're just having to work on too many things in order to maintain the business, you know.
Yeah.
And so it becomes sort of a little self-defeating. So with all that in mind, certainly from my side of it, running the company, it's kind of like you have to be aware of that and plan accordingly.
Yeah.
But I still don't see it as a bad thing for the industry. It's just change, and change is not a bad thing. It might be inconvenient in the short term, but it will figure out longer term.
I think the industry would have liked to have seen a couple of extra years of a slight growth. After, you know, I think they only had one or two in some territories before, especially in the US, before things started turning downwards again. Yeah, I think on that, they probably would have enjoyed a slightly longer breather, but it wasn't to be. So what can you do?
No.
And finally, I wanted to highlight, if you are from the US or other territories, I know that, you know, 50% or more of my audience is in the US, that there was an interesting BBC produced video unveiled featuring huge music names, including Pharrell, Elton John, Stevie Wonder, Coldplay, One Direction, who are all covering God Only Knows by the Beach Boys. And the song has been released as a single, and proceeds will go to the charity's Children in Need. But this has drawn some criticism, first of all, for the decision of the BBC to simulcast across these channels the airing of the video. The BBC is also seen by some to have too much power when it comes to artist development. Whilst, on the other hand, I would sort of say that in the UK, it's an invaluable tool, in the sense that the in commercial TV, I can't see hardly any music programming going on of any depth, really. So without the BBC, it would be a pretty tough spot for artists to get any airtime on TV. So yeah, I don't know. of course, the song is very much middle of the road. There's nothing exceptional. These things rarely are exceptional. It's a one line by line sung by different people, so you can't really get incredible artistic results from that. Darren, what are your thoughts around sort of the BBC and the video and sort of their role?
First, they butchered a song that I hold extremely dear, so I'm not happy about that. For that in a row. Yeah, you know, that's I think that is one of the sort of unquestionably most incredible songs ever created, and I say created specifically in place of written, because it's one thing to write a song like that, but to realize it in the way Brian Wilson did originally, I think was just a masterstroke that was unlikely to be repeated, you know. So for that they get a black mark, because I watched it and I was a bit just like, oh god, you know,
what is happening.
Yeah, it's like watching a great film reenacted by the village idiot in some respects. It's really unpleasant. But I don't know. I mean, I have to be honest. I just felt like the whole thing felt like a big grand showboating exercise. And it's a sign I work in the business too much. I was just looking at it all thinking, how much did this cost? Like, I know, you know. That's
it took years to put together as well.
Yeah, 2 years apparently to put together. Really? For that? I mean, that in itself, it's like, Jesus, could you not have been focusing on something else? I feel very conflicted about it.
Right.
I sort of agree with you that there is not great music programming elsewhere. I think my one counterpoint to that would be that Sky Arts, actually, in their defense, right, has done quite a lot of pretty good music programming. It's just that for various reasons, I don't think they really get particularly high viewing figures.
Plus, it's Sky, so I don't have Sky, for example, so never seen any of them.
But it is commercial TV.
Right.
You know, so if in that context of commercial TV making music programming, they are doing it. And Sky Arts almost goes completely the other way and is, you know, picking up a lot of pretty niche footage, you know, sort of jazz artists live at venues and stuff like that, you know, which is good for them. I wish the BBC had done something that ran a little deeper than just rolling out a bunch of famous people covering a song. I don't really know what I'm supposed to feel about that.
Right.
Like, it doesn't improve the song. I'm not wowed by the star power. I'm too old to sit there and be like, oh my god, it's One Direction, you know. I don't care. And against that, I mean, I have to say, it brought back to mind a kind of, there was a study by I don't think it was the Radio Academy, but it was a radio body recently that basically found, you know, it kind of accused the BBC of just not doing enough to serve specialist audiences across its radio network. And very much pointed the finger at sort of radios 1 and 2, just saying, you know, right, your daytime program in particular is not greatly different to any commercial radio station and just doesn't do enough to deliver on the BBC's remit, which is kind of to not compete with the commercial radio stations and to deliver programming that, you know, perhaps wouldn't otherwise survive if it wasn't, you know, publicly funded, which I don't think means that the whole radio should sort of, you know, translate overnight into some horror of, you know, weak unsigned upcoming bands and everything. But I definitely read that report and felt a degree of agreement with the way in which Radio One holds such a dominant position. And whilst there, you know, Radio One did respond saying, you know, we disagree completely and we have a very broad spectrum of specialist programming, it's kind of like, well,
at 3 o'clock in the morning.
You sort of do, but in the twilight hours, and, you know, it annexes this stuff to being very much the mainstay of people that are prepared to tune in at 10 o'clock at night and things like that. So I sort of agree with that, but I just felt that the two made for quite an interesting point of comparison. You know, the BBC on the one hand are being accused of not doing enough to support these new artists and things like that, and on the other, they sort of deliver this slightly weird showboating video that I just don't really understand the point of. It was sort of endings, it, you know, ostensibly the thrust of it was, you know, we're the BBC and we love music, and it was a bit sort of like, well, do you? Like, you know, it takes more than a token 3 minute, you know, extremely expensive video to deliver on that. So I feel conscious that throughout today's show I've been something of a moody git, and I'm really not, you know, I'm not in a bad mood or anything, but it's just that cold light of day where you're stepping back and going, look, it's just a video.
Really? Yeah. I mean,
so what does it mean?
I understand that the remit is to reach the most people possible, so you and I are not the targets of that video. But I wonder how the general public might have perceived that, as far as, I don't know. Maybe it was just a celebration of the fact that they already are. You know, they have been loving music for, you know, the past however many years, and that was just sort of a celebration and to sort of show the general public that that's still the case. But you wonder why that was necessary. And I guess, you know, it's great that it's for children in need, and so of course, you know, can't take anything away from that if the song does well, which I hope it does, then you know, a lot of money will be raised for charity. But yeah, it's very conflicted about the whole thing.
Yeah, I mean, I would say actually to give them a break, you know, they did announce earlier in the year that they were kind of reinvigorating their music programming.
Yeah.
And they'd kind of reformatted things a little bit around radio, and they were doing various other bits, and I suspect this may even be the sort of opening gambit to those shows then coming along and starting and things like that. And aside from the slightly perplexing award show that I think we've discussed on here last time I was on, that I kind of don't, again, you know, it sort of, it feels unnecessary to me. I don't really understand why they thought that'd be a good idea. But that aside, you know, yeah, it could be that this is the sort of preamble to slightly more focus around music. And if that's the case, all power to them. You know, I'll happily sit here in 6 months or a year and say, you know, it doesn't matter about the video, because they actually delivered on what they promised and really did dial up the volume of quality music broadcasting across radio and TV. And if that's the case, good on them. And, you know, I have to say, as much as I stand here and moan and be an ace and all of it, you know, BBC4 in particular has done some phenomenal music television. You know, really, really good stuff. And long may that continue. You know, I know that BBC4 has been sort of under consideration for retirement and things like that. And I couldn't disagree more with that kind of that view. You know, it'd be awful if that was lost. So, you know, the BBC do try. They do fairly well. I like a lot of public companies, I greatly sympathise with their plight, because there's always tabloids and commercial media trying to give them a good kicking. And I think the current government in particular, I think, would quite delight in sort of shutting it down and privatising it. So, you know, we have to have a degree of belief in them, and all power to them. But, yeah, I just sort of felt with the videos, a little bit, just maybe a bit perplexing, you know, you look at it and you think, why? You know,
and it was almost like a Christmas video, but it's still October, so it's very confusing to me.
Yeah, it was all a little bit puzzling, but, yeah, exactly. You know, if it's part of a longer play, then
it's all
fair
good.
Enough.
It's all good. Yeah. And well, I think we can wrap up with this. Just a couple of things to mention. Amazon is set to be opening a store in Manhattan before the holiday rush. It's going to be like a warehouse type experience where people can go and pick up their online purchases. Some question marks on whether that might grant music a bit of a boost, because people are going to be able to order CDs and pick them up at the Amazon warehouse, whilst there aren't that many record stores left in Manhattan to where you can actually do that. And on the other side, Kim.com has realized that as hard as he might try with Baboom, the industry would never back him, essentially, if he was part of the company. And so he decided to retire from the company. He sold his 45% share, although we don't know the details of that. And he's no longer going to have any role in Baboom at all. Of course, Baboom was planning on giving music away for free and then make people install a special ad blocker, which substituted the normal advertising for Baboom's own inventory advertising. And finally, Deezer has announced a partnership with Vodafone in South Africa and named Christian Harris as the new MD for UK and Ireland. And that's pretty much it. Darren, anything that you wanted to mention on your side that you're doing or promoting or wanted to plug?
I've got something coming on Monday.
Ooh,
with
great.
One of my bands, Superfood, that I work with
awesome.
Infectious. We've built something so... It involves Sid Lawrence, which it and the guys at We Make Awesome Shit, which I think will give you some insight as to the level we're operating on here. Definitely at the fun end of the spectrum. Unfortunately, what we've built is so fun, it's distracted everyone from working. And it's become we've mailed around. I need to get emails back going, it's been an hour and I'm still playing this fucking thing. that lands on Monday, and it's been great fun. Awesome. I think the guys that We Make Awesome Shit have had almost more fun than me on that one. But it's been a great laugh. It's the band love it, the label love it, I love it, and we launch it on Monday. So keep an eye on Superfood. You can find them on Facebook, or if you go to superfoodjunk.com, it will go live on the front page of that at some point on Monday. But awesome. Yeah, I'm really looking forward to rolling that out, because it's just going to put a smile on faces, and you know, I think we need a bit of that at the moment.
Absolutely, so, yeah.
The more of that, the better. So,
winter's rolling in, and you know, the leaves are leaves are losing the trees. No, the trees are losing the leaves.
You're losing your mind.
I'm losing my mind, and that should be the end of the show, really, before I make a fool of myself. Well, thank you so much, Darren, for joining me today. Once again, check out motiveunknown.com and sign up to the Daily Digest, which is a great way to keep up with what's happening in the music industry every day with Darren's super commentary. And I, of course, am at digitalmusictrends.com. You can find the show on the site or pretty much anywhere, YouTube, SoundCloud, MixCloud, you name it. If you'd like to subscribe to the newsletter, check out bit.ly/DMT list. And that's pretty much all for this week. Thanks so much for listening. Have a fantastic week, and till next time.